May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Good morning. And welcome again on this joyous baptismal occasion. It's great to see you all here at Trinity. This morning I want to ask the children later on, I think I have a little children's time, what is the meaning of this $20 bill? So stay tuned. What is its worth? Today I want to ask about the value of not just money, but what is the value of life? What's the value of one life? And that was a hard question for a lawyer who was asked to be put in charge of the Victims Compensation Fund after 9/11. The Compensation Fund gave money to the family of each person who died in the attacks on September 11th. And this lawyer was very challenged by his task. How is he going to figure out what is the value, what is the worth of one person's life? And as we know, over 2,000 people died that day. So the lawyer Feinberg came up with a formula, and the formula would consider the age of the victim, their dependents, whether they had life insurance or not, and what their income and their earning potential were. And it was amazing how dramatically the value assigned to the different victims varied. As little as $250,000 for blue-collar workers who died on 9/11. As much as $7.1 million for executives who were victims that day. But later on, this lawyer, Feinberg, found himself reflecting on his experience of trying to give a valuation to human life. And he said, as I met with the 9/11 families and wrestled with the issues surrounding the values of the lives lost, I began to question the basic premise of our legal system. He told this all to National Public Radio some time ago. He said, I was trained in the law. I have always accepted that no two lives were worth the same in financial terms. But now, I found the law in conflict with my growing belief in the equality of all life. Well, in our Genesis reading from the Hebrew scripture this morning, we struggle with the same issue. We see that the value of one life is made more important than the value of another life. Abraham had two sons, Isaac and Ishmael. Ishmael, born first by Abraham's concubine, Hagar. And then the second son, the legitimate son, born of his wife, Sarah, who didn't believe that she could have a child in old age, and so she said to the concubine, go in and lie with my husband. And indeed, she had a son that Sarah was going to claim as her own, but then when she had her own son, two little boys started to play together as babies. She saw that the older boy, Ishmael, was teasing Isaac the way big brothers do, and this annoyed Sarah, the legitimate wife. She was protective of her little son when he was born. And so she started to make a demand. She demanded that the slave woman, Hagar, be cast out of the family, totally cut off. And she was taking no chances that the slave woman's child would inherit anything from his father, Abraham. So in effect, what was Sarah doing? She was insisting that her child was more important than the concubine's child. And in deep sadness, the father, Abraham, and I didn't notice this until after the 8 o'clock service, but if you look at that passage in Genesis, God actually tells Abraham to listen to Sarah. Abraham's going to listen. But he's following God's will in this scripture reading. He complies with Sarah's wishes, gets up early in the morning, and he sends Hagar and his son Ishmael with a bit of bread and water out into the wilderness. But of course, soon the bread and water run out, and the child faints from weakness, and Hagar takes her young son and places him under a shady bush, and she said, I can't watch him die, went a little bit away off and sat down and waited for her fate and the fate of her son. And just at that moment in the hot desert heat, what should happen when all seemed hopeless, suddenly a messenger from God appeared to her and asked what was wrong. The messenger said, "Do not be afraid, for God is with you. God has heard the voice of your child crying in the wilderness." And the angel said to Hagar, "God is going to make a great nation out of your son. And that is the nation of Islam that we know today." And we see from the story that God does not abandon this child, Ishmael, nor does he abandon his mother, Hagar, the slave woman. Instead, God acts outside of the chosen ones, represented by the line of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And in the deathly heat of the desert, God's messenger brings water and new life. And of course, in Christianity, we're descended from the Jews, from Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Jesus was a Jew. So Christians come from that line. We have water as a symbol of baptism, of new life. And new life is resurrection. So water, resurrection, these are gifts we cherish in our faith. And they're present in this story, the gifts that were given to Ishmael and Hagar in the desert. Getting back to our question, what is one life worth? Can we put a dollar sign on our lives? God says every life is precious. What we give worth to is what we worship. Right? That's where the word worship comes from. What do we give worship to? Well, we give worship to the God of life and the God of love. Over and over again, we see in the stories of Scripture that this God, life and love, goes out to the margins, to those who are cast out. And he says, "I care about the illegitimate child. I care about the orphan. I care about the downtrodden, the refugee, the person who is grieving, the person who has been oppressed." And surely this is the message that Jesus spreads in his gospel. It starts with baptism and ends with resurrection. And so we see in the gospel, even if the helpless little sparrow who in the ancient marketplace was only worth 2 pennies, even if that sparrow is precious to God, aren't we all so precious? How much more precious are you in God's eyes? So God offers mercy toward all who turn to him, slave and free, Jew and Gentile, Muslim, powerful and powerless. Each is a treasure in God's eyes, and we're all invited to hear his voice, just as Hagar did when she thought all was lost in the wilderness of Haran. Now, if we think about the main things that cause contentiousness or bitterness in families, it usually comes down to wanting something that somebody else has, because we feel like we're not going to have enough. And Sarah wanted all of Abraham's attention. She wanted her child to inherit all of the birthright of Abraham. She wasn't interested in sharing that once her son was born. She was desperately looking out for number one. And so she turned heartless against Hagar, the Egyptian slave woman. And even if Hagar were smug about bearing the first child, the first son, that didn't give Sarah the right to use her power as the official wife and throw Hagar into a forsaken environment like the desert. And neither is Abraham's behavior commendable, is it? He colluded with Sarah's cruel plan, putting his own son's future in jeopardy. Both abused the power they had against a vulnerable woman and child. So we have to be aware of family feuds in our own families, don't we? Family feuds can lead to evil, to casting people away, casting people out, and that's not right. Today's gospel tells every disciple who wants to follow Jesus, forsake any power but God's power. If God goes to the margins, we should be not also go out to the edges where people are feeling rejected. We should even forsake family loyalties and family bonds if they come before God. This is what we call the hard sayings of the gospel. Very hard to digest today's gospel. One says, I'm going to pit mother against father, mother God must be first, is what the scriptures are saying, what Jesus is saying. We're to take our cross and follow him. Family is important, so we mustn't confuse this lesson this morning. Many of us hold family sacred, but with family interests become higher priority than doing the will of God, then family can become sacrilege. Sarah really was family with Hagar. Their sons were brothers, sons who became the fathers of nations, and those nations were still estranged today, Jew, Muslim, Christian people. So we go back to these source stories in Genesis to see how it all started. It all starts with a family, jealousy, and covetousness that lead to a feud. Well, as Abraham's descendants, Christian, Muslim, and Jew, we could each claim to be elected by God, to be more special than the others, to leave the others unchosen. Or we could see that the family of God is bigger than any one of us. In fact, some of our Trinity parishioners were at iftar this week at the community center, Muslim Community Center in Bridgeport, invited to share in that feast in Irene. And they were building a bridge. They're not saying I'm joining the Muslim faith. They're just saying we're here as your brothers and sisters of the Christian faith, friends, to try to understand one another. And that's what we're called by Christ to do, to love one another as God loves us. Well, there's a mystery to appreciating one another, isn't it? It's the mystery of mutual giftedness. If I can look for the gifts that you bring to the table, if you see the gifts in me, that's how we're going to work together. That's how we're going to try to move forward together. If I could see the divinity in you as God's chosen child, if you see the divinity in me as God's chosen child, that is going to move us forward in our relationships. Well, today in our baptism of little baby Alexandra Ulrich, we're saying, essentially, when we baptize her, that God treasures her and that we welcome her into God's family. There's nothing, not even the most helpless baby, that's outside of God's care. And you can have quiet, or big brother help us pour the water for the baptismal font. But when you know that you're loved and cared for, what happens? Then you're able to go out into a sometimes dangerous or threatening world and share the lessons that you've learned. We can be faithful disciples of Christ, seeing the divinity in others who seem so different. Even when it feels scary to do that, when no one else is attempting it, we are called to do that, to speak God's truth and to show God's love in the world. So, in conclusion, I want to circle back to that story about the lawyer, Kevin Feinberg. After the September 11th attacks, and after he completed his work with the compensation fund to give money to the victims' families, Kevin Feinberg was called upon again. Guess who called him? The president of Virginia Tech. This time it was right after the terrible mass shooting at that university. And the president of Virginia Tech called up Mr. Feinberg. He said, "Could you manage the victims' fund here at our university that would distribute that compensation to the families of all who were killed on that tragic day in 2007? And Feinberg said, "You know, I would be honored to help you, but I need to share with you the lessons that I learned after 9/11. That I wrestled with the truth in that experience." And so he took off his lawyer's hat, and he put on his human hat, and he said, "This time, all victims, students and faculty alike, the janitor in the hallway, everybody, would receive the same compensation." So what is the worth of one life? To God,